Hi everyone, welcome to the Good Morning Test. This is Nisha Najmuddin. I'm an economics faculty, specialized in handling sessions for various competitive examinations like UPSC, UGC NET Bank, etc. I'm a faculty who handles sessions exclusively for UPSC, especially economics and current affairs, both online as well as offline. So in various online platforms like Unacademy, my own YouTube channel like Nisha Najmuddin for UPSC, I do handle sessions for economics and current affairs and offline. I exclusively work at Kingmakers Eyes Academy and I'm also handling economy optional guys. So those who are interested to take your economy as an optional subject, I'll be handling that subject at Kingmakers Eyes Academy. So you can join the classes very soon. It is not started yet. We are waiting for the number of students to enroll. So once it is done, I'll be starting the economy optional at Kingmakers Eyes Academy. So apart from that, guys, in this Good Morning Test, as we normally do, a set of MCQs exclusively based on current affairs for the month June 2019 will be discussed in a detailed manner. So now a 360 degree coverage of your current affairs on a daily basis in the form of questions, which is very, very relevant to the upcoming UPSC prelims examination, will be discussed. So the whole idea of this Good Morning Test is to enable the candidates to understand what sort of questions that they can expect from their current affairs for the UPSC prelims examination. So as I keep telling you every time, whenever you get an MCQ question, the first thing that you have to identify is the keyword. So whenever you get a question for your MCQ, guys, the first thing you have to identify is what the keywords, as to whether you have to identify the correct statement or the incorrect statement. After that, try to understand or establish a proper connection linkage between the various statements that is given in the question. After that, the third important step that you have to keep in mind is the method of elimination or the elimination trick. So these are simple logic that you have to apply whenever you are solving any MCQ questions. And now, as usual, a set of 10 MCQs exclusively based on current affairs, which are taken from authenticated sources like The Hindu, PIB, Times of India, Internet Express, all these newspapers and magazines will be discussed in this particular session. So to begin with, guys, the first question of today's session, as per June 25, 2019 current affairs, is with reference to curiosity, consider the following statement. So what is the keyword? The keyword here is curiosity. So keeping that in mind, we are going to analyze the following statements. Option 1 tells, it is a car-sized rover designed to explore what? The crater Galar Earth's moon. So now, the keyword is car-sized. Of course, we know it's a car-sized rover. And now another keyword is on Earth's moon. Do you think it is on Earth's moon or it is Mars or some other planet? Think. Second one, it is launched by NASA. So more or less, we know that Curiosity, which is a car-sized rover design and all, definitely it will be by NASA, right? More or less, you can understand that the second option could be right. So now, the question is, you have to identify the correct statement. So again, the keyword in the question is to identify the correct statement. Sometimes you can ask you to identify the incorrect statement also. So those kind of questions are not that common, but still UPSC can ask you. So now you have to be very, very careful whether it is the right one or the incorrect one. So here, since it's the correct statement, which one do you think, guys, is the right statement out of these two statements? Is it only option 1 or only 2 or both are right, or option with details, neither 1 or 2? And the answer is option number 2, which means that the B is the right answer. Okay. That is, it is launched by NASA, whereas the first one is wrong. Why? If you see the Curiosity, guys, it is also a car-sized rover designed to explore the crater, Gale. But on what? Is it on the Earth's moon or on some other planet? If you see, it is actually to explore the crater Gale on where, guys? On Mars. Actually, it is not Earth, moon, rather Mars. So now, why is your first sentence or statement wrong? It is wrong just because of the keyword Earth, moon. So up to crater Gale, of course, this particular sentence statement is correct. But now after crater Gale, the next word is what? On Earth's moon. It's actually not on Earth's moon, rather it is on Mars. Okay, that is why the first one was wrong. So now talking about Curiosity, I can tell you that it is nothing but the Curiosity team, guys. They have detected a methane many times over the course of the mission. And now this Curiosity is nothing but a car-sized rover designed so that they'll be able to explore what? The crater Gale on Mars. And that too is as a part of the NASA's missions, okay? Of your Mars Science Laboratory mission. As part of that, really, they did this. Now, what is this MSL, guys? The Mars Science Laboratory. That is nothing but a robotic space probe mission to Mars, which is launched again by NASA. And now, the main aim or objective of this particular mission is nothing but it includes, you know, investigating Mars habitability, then also studying the climate of Mars and geology, and also collecting certain data for a manned mission exclusively to this planet called as Mars. So exclusively giving importance for the planet Mars, and to know more details about that, only this particular team came up with this Curiosity. Okay, so thus I can even tell you this particular Curiosity, which is a car-sized rover, guys, is also exciting. Why? For the fact that the microbial life, that is very important source of methane on Earth, right? But if you see the same methane, guys, that can also be created through interactions between rocks and water. So that is the whole point, guys, why this particular Curiosity mission has been very exciting. Now, moving on, the next question is, which of the following member or members is or are both of your Association of Southeast Nations and also your RCEP, that is Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership. So in yesterday's current affairs class, we have discussed some 2 to 3 questions based on Association of Southeast Asian Nations. So by this time, I hope you would have a clear idea regarding what is Asian Nations. Okay. So now apart from that, you have another important keyword also in your question. What is that? You also have to identify the members of your RCEP also. That is Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership. It is very important to know about that also. Sometimes for UPSC, from the economics perspective, current affairs perspective as well as theoretical perspective, you can get questions based on your RCEP also. Anyway, I'll be discussing regarding this in the explanation. So option number 1 is Myanmar to Philippines, Thailand, Vietnam, India, Japan. So now out of these, you have to tell which of the following members are both in your Asian as well as RCEP. Option number 1, 3, 4 and 6, whereby they are saying 2 and 5 is not there. B tells 2, 4, 5 and 6 and C tells 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5. 6 is not there. That's Japan is not there. Whereas D tells 1, 2, 3 and 4. Guys, if you look at this, given options or code, it is very well understood that one of the options is wrong. Because there is no single option which tells that all the above is right. Okay, there is no single option option like that. So in that case, you have to do an elimination technique. So now if you see almost in every options, option number 1 is there, be it A, B, C and B, D, you can find, 1. Which means that yes, Myanmar will be there. Now, what about your, option number 2, that's Philippines. Again, if you see, in all the 3 options you have it. What about Thailand? Thailand also, again, you have in majority of options. What about India? Yeah, now talking about India, you have option number 5, that is India, only in second and, third one. That is only in B and C you have, option number 5, that is India. So, do you think Association of Southeast Asian Nations, a country India is also a member? Yesterday, in the discussion regarding Asian Nations, we discussed that there are 10 members. In that 10 members, do you think India was also included in that? So now those who attended yesterday's class will be able to make a quick guess. If you are feeling that India is not included, in that case you can easily do the elimination technique by saying that option number B and also C, that cannot be right. Whereas 1 and D, out of 1 and D you have to go for option, you have to go for the answers. In that again Japan. If you see Japan also, do you think it's a part of your Association of Southeast Asian Nations? Because in India, if you think India is not there, do you think that Japan will also be there? Think. So now you have option number 1, which talks about again 6. Whereas the option number D doesn't talks about 5 and 6. Rather 1, 2, 3 and 4 they talks. Whereas India and Japan, they're excluding it. So now there are more probability or chances for which option, guys, to be right. And the option is answer number D, which means that only 1, 2, 3 and 4 is right. Which means that 5 and 6, that is India and Japan, are not the members. That's very much understood also, right? Because as I told you, yesterday when we discussed, if you take the 10 members of Association of Southeast Asian Nations, India doesn't come under that. And now even Japan, if India doesn't come under that, automatically Japan will also be not a part of it, for the fact that we know that it's a wonderful country where it is having a lot of cordial relationship with our country, India. And not only that, though in that Association of Southeast Asian Nations, we are supposed to be a part also, we're not a part of it. It is very well understood, right? So now, because of that the reason, the answer is option number D. That is only 1, 2, 3 and 4 is right, whereas 5 and 6 is wrong. So now, what is this Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership, guys? It's very important to know what is that. It's nothing but it's a proposed free trade agreement, guys, between the 10 members of world, your Association of Southeast Asian Nations. Actually, your Association of Southeast Asian Nations and your RCEP, both are related. For the fact that your Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership is nothing but a free trade agreement. And that means that free trade agreement is among the 10 members of your Association of Southeast Asian Nations. So they are both connected, okay? And those 10 member states consist of your, Myanmar, Philippines, Malaysia, Indonesia, Cambodia, Thailand, Vietnam, Singapore, etc. And also along with that, it also consists of 6 Asia-Pacific states with which your Asian, that is Association of Southeast Asian Nations, they have certain existing free trade agreements. And that consists of your country like India, then Japan, China, Australia, South Korea, New Zealand. Okay. So this is all about your Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership. Now, why would such a kind of partnership come up, guys? If you see, the main intention or the objective aim of this Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership is nothing but they want to increase or boost the trade, goods trade. And that way they can do that only by eradicating or eliminating what? some of the most tariff and non-tariff barriers. We know that there exists a lot of tariff and non-tariff barriers, right? You have to remove all those things. So to remove that only, automatically the goods trade will be boosted up. So that is the aim of your RCEP, okay? And now this is a move, guys, I can tell you, that is expected to provide the region's consumer a greater choice of quality products at affordable prices. That is, they want to provide the best quality products at very cheaper or reasonable rates. That is the main reason why they've come up with such a kind of elimination. Okay, as a part of the aim of a regional comprehensive economic partnership. And thus, I can tell you, RCEP negotiations, they were formally launched way back in the year 2012. And that too, it was done at their Association of Southeast Asian Nations Summit, which was held in Cambodia. During that time only, we had our RCEP negotiations. Okay. Now, moving on to the next one is, consider the following statements with respect to special category status. Option 1 tells, the constitution does not have any provision for categorization of any state as a special category status. So now this appears to be a little logical, right? Don't you think so? The constitution, it does not have any right for categorization. Second one, currently 11 states, they are having special category status in India. So now the key word in the second statement is what, guys? It is 11. Do you think it is 11 or 3 or 4 or 5? So think and give the right answers, guys. Mostly we know that already 3 states, they were given special category status, no doubt in that. But do you think after that, initially it was 3 and did they increase it later? Or did they, decrease it? Or is it like, are they constant? Or even if they've increased also, apart from 3 states, has it become to 11 or is it like 5, 8 or 9? 9 states. So we'll be having a conclusion like that, right? Anyways, keeping all these things in mind, your answer is option number C, which means that both 1 and 2 statements are perfectly right, guys. Yes, if you see the constitution, they do not have any provision for what? For categorization of any state by giving them a status called the special category status. And currently, as per the recent data, 2019 data, I can tell you that 11 states, guys, they are having a status called as special category status in our country, India. But if you see, as I told you initially, if you see, there are only 3 states, that is Assam, Nagaland, Jammu and Kashmir. They were granted special status before, guys. But since then, I can tell you, 8 more states have been included. So now 3 plus 8 makes it 11. So altogether, I can tell you, currently 11 states have been given that special status in our country, India. And which are the remaining 8 states, guys? Apart from Assam, Nagaland, and J&K, the remaining 8 states that was included to give a special status in our country includes Arunachal Pradesh, Himachal Pradesh, Sikkim, Mizoram, Meghalaya, Tripura, Uttarakhand. You can see many of the northeastern states also included here. It's in a way just to improve the condition of the northeastern states also, because they're also important, right? And thus I can tell you, this concept of special category state that was first introduced way back in the year 1969, and that too when the 5th Finance Commission, they sought to provide, you know, certain disadvantaged states with preferential treatment in the form of central assistance and tax breaks. To put it in a nutshell, I can tell you, the whole idea is they want to bring up all these states which are backward. So now when these states are at a disadvantage, it is the duty of the government to make sure that we are improving. So that is why they've given a special category status. So more focus will be given to those states to bring them up. That is the whole point. Okay, that is how the special category state status concept was put forward. Now, if you see the central government, okay, they pay 90% of the funds, guys, which are required in a centrally sponsored scheme. And now there's a special category states, whichever states which is meant, out of the 11 states, I can tell you any scheme or any program exclusively for these states, the sponsoring will be done both by the central as well as the state government. And now mostly the programs will be centrally sponsored scheme. There is a difference between central sector scheme and centrally sponsored scheme. As I told in the previous classes also, central sector scheme means what? 100% funding is done by the central government. What about centrally sponsored scheme? A part of the funding will be done by the state government. For example, 50% by center and 50% by state. Or it could be 60% by the center as well as 40% by the state. It depends. The ratio depends. Okay. Anywhere there will be a kind of sharing. That is called a centrally sponsored scheme. So now keeping in mind the special category states, I can tell you that the central government, they will pay 90% of funds, guys, which is required in a centrally sponsored scheme, to the special category status category states, whichever state is given out of these 11 states, whichever state is coming under that category, they will be given. 90% of the funds will be by the central government. And now, as against 60% in case of normal category states. See, we know that apart from these 11 states, there are also some of the other states in our country, right? So now, in case of other states which do not come in the special category states, for example, states like Tamil Nadu, Kerala and all, they do not come under the special category status, right? So now, in case of a centrally sponsored scheme where the ratio is to be shared by the central government and state government for the funding, okay, it will be like 60% will be done by the center, the remaining 40 should be done by the state. That is the normal ratio. But in case of the states which are having a special category status, what happens, instead of the normal 60% share which is given by the central government under the centrally sponsored scheme, what they do is that 90% will be done by that. So more or less the majority funding will be done by the central government. And the remaining 10%, that 10% will be borne by the respective state government, which comes under the status called a special category state status. Okay, that is the whole point. And now, if you see the NDC, they first accorded the special category status in the year 1969, guys. And that too to JNK, Jammu and Kashmir, Assam and Nagaland. And after that, over the years, what happened? We understood that there are so many other states also which require special attention. And that is how 8 more states, guys, that was added to the list. And these are the 8 states, okay? And now if you see, in the year 2010, the last state to be added was Uttarakhand. So you can, and let's see, if the condition of our country is going like this, obviously more and more states would also be added. So because there are many states, still there are some states, guys, which are not able to perform better in so many diverse perspectives, be it your economic as well as social indicators. So now accordingly, as and when the schemes are progressing, maybe we can even see some more states also coming under the category called as special category status. Let's see how it goes, guys. Now, the next question is, recently the term representative concentration pathway is seen in news. Now, the question is, what is that all about? Option A, it is international north-south transport corridor. B, software tools for artificial intelligence. C, it is Bitcoin's regulations. And D, it is greenhouse gas concentration. So now this is a wonderful question, and all the options, it is a very, very simple option where you can easily pick out the answer because it's not a confusing option. So which one do you think is your representative concentration pathway? Is it Bitcoins, or is it artificial intelligence, or is it your international north-south transport corridor? And the answer is option number D, which means it's greenhouse gas concentration, guys. So now I can tell you that a representative concentration pathway, what is that? It's nothing but a greenhouse gas concentration, but not emissions, guys. So people will think it is an emission of greenhouse. It's not the case. That's why I've specifically mentioned it is not emissions, but rather concentration trajectory. Okay. Which is adopted by whom? By your IPCC for its 5th assessment report way back in the year 2014. TK. And now these representative concentration pathways, which is nothing but a greenhouse gas concentration, they're also consistent with a wide range of possible changes in the future anthropogenic, that is the human greenhouse gas emissions. Then, and the main aim is what, guys? Nothing but to present their atmospheric concentrations. We know that today the greenhouse gas emissions has caused a lot of issues, right? At the end of the day, leading to global warming, climate issues and all this stuff. So now it's very important to do something for that. So such a kind of representative concentration path, which is a greenhouse gas concentration, will enable to represent what the atmospheric concentrations. Okay. Now, moving on, the next question is, so before that, guys, before going to the question, some of the important details that I've given you here is this RCP, okay, that is representative concentration pathway scenario. They refers to what a rise in greenhouse gas emissions throughout the 21st century. And if you see the RCP 4.5 scenario, they refers to one in which the greenhouse gas emissions that will peak around 2040 and decline. So now you have something called as representative concentration path 8.5 and 4.5. So now what is 8.5? 8.5 is nothing but they are talking about the rise in greenhouse gas emissions throughout our 21st century. What about RCP 4.5, guys? That is nothing but, again, that is also greenhouse gas emissions, but that they are saying that as per the 4.5 scenario, it will peak or increase around 2040 and then it will start declining. That is the major difference between RCP 8.5 and RCP 4.5. Okay, these are the findings, guys, based on your greenhouse gas emissions, called as representative concentration path. They give us a lot of serial numbers for that, okay? Based on that, they'll categorize it. And if you see from all these findings, what about our country India, guys? What is the position of our country India? If you see, it can be inferred that from all these findings, our country India is, India too is projected to experience what? The frequent occurrence of certain unprecedented high temperatures over the next 20 years. And that's pretty much true also. What are we facing right now? We are in all the metro cities. Even if you see the case of Chennai also, what is happening in Tamil Nadu as a whole? I can tell you that the temperatures are too high, where we are facing a lot of issues. That is perfectly true, right? Even our country, India, we are experiencing such kind of situations. Not only in Chennai or Tamil Nadu, but all the other parts of the states as well. And now, guys, more information regarding this particular topic, that is representative concentration pathway. You can, copy this link and you can search it out. Okay, it's taken from the Indian Express. So, this is a place where I've taken this, question. So, you can, refer to that particular source for more information. That is why I have given you a link here. Okay. Now, moving on, the next question is, with respect to the International Court of Justice, which of these statements is or are correct? So, the keyword here is to identify the correct one. So option B it is, it's a principal judicial organ of the UN. B, the seat of court is located in the Netherlands. C, the court is composed of more than 20 judges. So now it's all about the International Court of Justice. So of course, when it is about the international, guys, the key word is what? Again, International Court of Justice. So obviously, if it is international or global thing, yeah, it will consist of the, you know, it will be a principal organ of the UN. There is no doubt in that because the word international is here. And definitely, UN is an international organ. So in that case, we can easily, the connection link of the question is, yeah, the first one could be right. And now, since it's the International Court of Justice, yeah, it is located in Netherlands. Do you think it is Netherlands or some other place? But there are chances for it to be Netherlands also. Some of the Scandic and Scandinavian countries. Mostly such kind of, things will be there only. And third one tells the court is composed of more than 20 judges. Do you think it is more than 20 judges or just 20 judges or less than 20? That is the question. So now this 20 judges, something is confusing, guys. That the more than 20 judges, you will be in a dilemma. So whether the third one will be right or wrong. And now you have an option called as D also, which tells that both A and B is correct. They are not including C there. Which means that the chances of option A and B to be correct is more. Rather than C. Because exclusively after giving single options called as A and B, again option B talks about A and B. It is highlighting those two points. Which means that you have to rethink on your option number C. Because if you say that your C is correct, there is no option which tells that A is also correct. Because we all know that A is correct. Now out of B and C you are confused. Right? Because more than 20 judges and Netherlands, these two things may confuse you. It could be less than 20 or more than, it could be just 20. And it could be located in Netherlands or Switzerland or anywhere else. So this is what is going in your mind. So now out of your options, how will you do the elimination technique, guys? You have option B, which tells A and B. So now A is coming in that. And now B is also included, which means that, okay, B can be right. But what about the third one? Third one is not included, which means that, yeah, your third option cannot be right because there is no option which tells that, A and C is there. It's only A and B. So now A is right. It could only be A. It could only be B or A and B. So you'll be confused. Definitely you don't have an option called as C there. And the answer is option number D, which means that only A and B is right, whereas C is wrong. Why, guys? Just because the keyword more than 20 judges. Because of the keyword more than 20 judges only, it is wrong. It is actually just 15, guys. The number is 15. Okay. If you see, the International Court of Justice. Yes, it is a principal judicial organ of your UN. And now this ICJ, guys, that was established way back in the year 1945. And that too by the Charter of UN. And also, though it was established in the year 1945, also, it began at work in the next year, in the year 1946. Now, this particular seat of the court, it is at the Peace Palace in The Hague, that is in Netherlands. Okay, so as you saw in the question, yes, the seat of the court, that is in Netherlands. And now, out of the six principal organs of UN, that is United Nations, it is the only one, that is the International Court of Justice, out of the six organs of UN. This is the only one which is not located where in New York. So that is why, guys, even I stressed on the second point. Because normally, if you're saying that your International Court of Justice, if they are a principal organ of UN, we know that there are six principal organs. And normally, when it is supposed to be a principal organ of UN, United Nations, definitely it would have its headquarters where in New York. So most of you will be, confused with that. But now there's an exception, guys. That is out of the six members or the six principal organs of UN, this International Court of Justice, that is the only one which is not located where in New York, that is UN States of America. Rather, it is placed where in Netherlands. So that is again another important key point that you have to keep in mind. So now UPSC will give you questions like this only because normally we have a notion. If it is UN means obviously it will be New York, the headquarters. But there is an exception and this is it. Okay, so please have a look at it. And now talking about the third point, that is the court is composed of more than 20 judges. That is wrong. It is not 20, rather only 15. The number is 15. Take care. If you see, this court is composed of 15 judges and they are elected for terms of office, guys. For how many years? Is it 5 years or 3 years? No, it is actually for 9 years. And that too by who does that? It is by the UN General Assembly and also the Security Council. They are the ones who elect the people or judges who can hold the office for a period of 9 years term. And now, though they do that also, it is assisted by a registry, which is the administrative organ. And what about the official languages, guys, of your ICJ? The official languages of your ICJ, that is International Court of Justices, English and French. And now, what is the role of this court? The role of the court is to settle in accordance with the international law all the legal disputes which are submitted to this particular court by the states. That's here they are talking about the countries. And also, as a part of it, they'll be able to give a lot of advisory opinions on all the legal questions referred to it by the authorized United Nations organ and specialized agency. So this is the role of the International Court of Justice. I hope this question is very clear to you, and also able to, I would have understood the slight, keyword, which made your answer as option number D. Because mostly you get confused in option number B, that's there. But I hope you clearly understood also the justification why that is correct. Now, the next one is, consider the following statements regarding MPC, Monetary Policy Committee. So now this is a wonderful question. This is an economy-based current affairs question, and it's a very similar question also. Option 1 tells us, it's a 6-member committee constituted by RBI. Yes, we all know that the Monetary Policy Committee, that is a 6-member committee. But the key word in the question is RBI. Do you think it's the central bank of a country that constitutes this committee? Think about it. Of course, we have members from RBI. We have members from Government of India. That is there. So now, though we have equal members from both RBI as well as Government of India, that is the Finance Ministry also, do you think it is constituted by RBI or it is by, government? Think. Second one, it is required to meet at least 4 times in a year. Yeah, that makes a sense. At least 4 times in a year. Okay. Third one, it determines the policy interest rate required to achieve inflation target. And again, the word inflation target shows that, yes, that will be a right answer. Because the Monetary Policy Committee, guys, why was that put forward? The sole reason why the Monetary Policy Committee was put forward is because they want to target inflation, right? Targeting inflation was, very, very important. And that's how they did also. The Urjit Patel committee, guys, way back when he was the ex-deputy governor, when he was the deputy governor, Mr. Urjit Patel, he formed a committee called as Dr. Urjit Patel Committee. And now under that committee only, this MPC was brought forward, and also they started to target inflation. And they said that hereafter the inflation should be targeted at how many percentage? At the rate of 4%. The with plus or minus 2 band of 2%. Which means that up to 6%, the maximum inflation can go up to 6%. The maximum should be 6%, but not more than that. And it can decrease up to 2%, not below that. So the maximum minimum points were, discussed or it was kept. But in spite of that also, the healthy zone or the healthy target was always 4%. And we all know that for a developing economy like India, it is impossible for us to think a situation without inflation. Because inflation is important. Because we are a developing economy. To an extent, that is required, guys. We can't say, no, we cannot have inflation. But that should be moderate. That is the whole idea. That is why they targeted inflation to how many percentage? To 4%. With the condition of plus or minus band of 2%. Okay. And now, along with that, they also took another important decision. That is, with respect to your, different measures of inflation. You all would have learned inflation properly in economics, right? You have WPI, that is Wholesale Price Index. You have Consumer Price Index. You have Producers Price Index. And all these concepts will be very well thorough when you have done your inflation. Out of that, your Wholesale Price Index, that was considered as the headline or the top line inflation. Okay. But later on, since your Wholesale Price Index takes into consideration only the price of goods at the bulk or mass level, it was facing some disadvantage because we know that it's not only goods but also services to be taken into consideration. And now your consumer price index, it is from the point of view of the consumers or the retail perspective, and that takes into consideration what the value of all goods as well as services. So services taken into consideration were in your CPI. So that is why in your MPC, guys, when they were targeting inflation, they also said that hereafter, it is not the WPI, but rather that is the Wholesale Price Index, rather the Consumer Price Index or your CPI, that will be considered as the index of inflation. That will be, and hereafter, now currently we are having the CPI as the index of inflation. And the reason is your Consumer Price Index, since it is from the retail perspective, it reflects the real cost of living of the individual consumers. So that has a reflection in the real cost of living. And also it takes into consideration what your goods and services, it measures the price of both goods and services. That is the whole point. Anyways, I hope this information is pretty much important for you. So whatever questions comes out of inflation targeting or a WPI or a CPI, you'll be able to answer. So now back to the question of discussion, that is MPC. Which one do you think is the right answer? Now we know that the first one, that's RBI. You have a confusion in that. You'll be thinking, is it RBI or government? So now in that case, look at your options. In your option, option number A, C and D, all these three options, they have one. And you know that one is more or less wrong. Whereas 2 and 3 is right. Though you have 2 and 3 in option number D as well as C also, you are kind of confused. Because you have option number 1 also in that, which means that those options are wrong. So option number B is the only option which does not contain option number 1. Right? In that case, 95% of chances is for your option number B to be right. And the answer is option number B, which means that only 2 and 3 is right. And I hope you've got the technique of identifying the answer also, guys. This is the way you should, do the elimination trick. Okay. And thus, if you see your Monetary Policy Committee, yes, it is a 6-member committee. Constituted by whom, guys? By the central government. As per the Section 45 ZB of the amended RBI Act of 1934. Why is the first one wrong? The first one is wrong just because of the keyword RBI. It is actually the central government. Okay. Just because of that, it is wrong. And the second and third one is perfectly correct. And thus, if you see, every year, at least four times, the monetary policy committee is required to meet. And why this MPC was put forward, guys? What is the reason? Because of the conflict between the government and RBI with reference to certain policy decisions and all, with reference to expenditure revenue. They had some conflicts, guys. Because RBI has its own policy, the Ministry of Finance has its own policy. Because of that conflict only, the committee called as MPC were put forward. And now, the quorum for the meeting of the MPC is how many members? Four members. Now, each member of their MPC, guys, they have one vote. And even if an equality of votes, there's a governor, guys, who has a second or casting vote. That is exclusively the discretionary power of the governor. Okay. Now, moving on to the next question is, and you can just go through, guys. I've just given you some information here. Apart from that, also, you can just go through. That is the resolution adopted by MPC that is published after the conclusion of every meeting of MPC. And now, once in every 6 months, the RBI, guys, they're required to publish all the documents called your monetary policy report. Why? Because they should literally be liable to explain the source of inflation, the forecast of inflation for 6 to 8 months, etc. That is why, guys, when I explained the question Monetary Policy Committee, I explained to you in detail regarding inflation targeting, because the whole idea of MPC is to target inflation. So that is the whole idea, right? So that is why I give a little information regarding inflation targeting also. So whatever questions based on that, if it comes also, you'll be able to answer. So we have done a 360 degree coverage of this particular topic. Moving on, the next question is the seventh question. With reference to Indian Regional Navigation Satellite System, consider the following statement. IRNSS, it has 3 satellites in the geostationary and 4 satellites in the geosynchronous orbits. Second one, IRNSS, it covers entire India and about 5,500 square kilometers beyond its borders. Third one, a country India will have its own satellite navigation system with full global coverage by the middle of 2019. So which one do you think is the right answer? And the answer is option number A, which means that only your one is right, or the second and third one is wrong. Why, guys? If you see, your Indian Regional Navigation Satellite, actually, it is nothing but, it has 3 satellites in geostationary, guys, and 4 satellites in orbits also. And this space segment, it consists of your IRNSS constellation of 8 satellites. And now, as you saw in the question, 3 are located where in the suitable orbit slots. Okay. And also, it is designed to provide accurate position information service to users in India as well as region, guys, extending up to 1,100 kilometers. But what is given here, it is said that it covers entire India and about 5,500 square kilometers beyond the border. That is wrong. Because of 5,500 only, the second one is wrong. Actually, it covers India. That is true. And also, around 1,500 kilometers from its boundary. Okay, that is the keyword, guys. So, instead of 5,500, it should be 1,500. In that case, it should have been correct, but since it is 5,500 only, it is wrong. And second one, a third one tells that India will have its own satellite navigation. They're saying like that. If you see, there are long-term plans to extend it to your South Asian Association Regional Cooperation region, but not by this year 2019, guys, but later on. And there are plans to add 4 more satellites to the present constellation. And if you see our country, India, definitely they will not. We will not have our own satellite navigation by the middle of 2019, because see, we may have, it is not like we will not have, but here the keyword again is middle of 2019. So in the explanation, it is clearly said that by 2019, we are not going to have it. So we may have, but not 2019. It may take some more years, but in the question, they said 2019. That is why the third one is wrong. Moving on to the eighth question is, in which of the following states Ranganathithu Bird Sanctuary is located? So it's a very, very simple question, because from the term Ranganathithu, it's very well understood that it could be in any of the south states, right? And option number 8 was Manipur, B, Andhra Pradesh, C, Kerala, Karnataka, and D, Kerala. So, apart from Manipur, option B, C, and D, more or less you may think any of these states. But now, again, out of B, C, and D, Ranganathithu, that particular word signifies it could either be from Andhra Pradesh or Karnataka. I hope you have heard about your Pakshikashi of Karnataka. That is called as your Ranganathithu bird. And the answer is option number C, that is Karnataka. If you see, the Ranganathithu bird sanctuary, it is also known as the Pakshikashi of Karnataka, and that is a bird sanctuary, guys, which is put up in Karnataka in the Mandya district. And now this particular human bird sanctuary, it was formed when Kantirava Narasimha Raja Vadiyar of that then Mysuru royal family, he constructed an embankment across the Kaveri way back in the year 1648. And that is how your Ranganathithu, it became a bird sanctuary in the year 1940. And that is because owing to the own initiatives and interest of the Notre Dame ornithologist Salim Ali. So that particular ornithologist called Mr. Salim Ali, because he took a lot of interest on that, and that is how the bird sanctuary called as Ranganathithu or the Pakshikashi came up. Okay. And also I can tell you this particular bird sanctuary is also important, guys, because it is an important nesting and breeding ground for thousands of bird species. That is why it became very famous. And also roughly I can tell you around 170 bird species they have been recorded in this particular Pakshikashi area of Karnataka called as Yeranganathu. Okay. And now this sanctuary, bird sanctuary, it is a home to straight-throated swallows, then great stone plover, painted stork, Asian open bill stork, common spoonbill, and a lot of other birds also, like Indian shag, strong-billed, kingfisher, cormorant, etc. So all the different species, they do come up here. It's actually a home to all these different species of birds. So automatically, this particular area, it is known for the birds as well. That's why it's called as a Pakshikashi of Karnataka. So Pakshikashi, obviously, the name itself suggests a variety of birds, of diversified things do come up here. And it's a home to these birds. So obviously, that particular place in Karnataka came to be called as the Ranganathu Bird Sanctuary, and it's very famous also. If you do get a chance to visit, please do visit, guys. It's a beautiful place to visit also. And because you're a UPSC aspirant, right? So whenever you go for outings and vacations, make a point that you visit some monuments or some kind of places where you've studied. So when you see and study something, it makes a lot of difference. So I just gave a suggestion. Anyways, it's a beautiful place to visit, guys. Anyways. And also, this is taken from the Hindu paper, guys, this particular question. So now the link of the question paper is given here. So even you can, click on the link or copy paste the link and you can read more about this. So those who are interested on this, you can read more about this particular Ranganathu Bird Sanctuary. Okay, I've given the link here. The next question is, with reference to the cultural history of India, the term Nilachal refers to what? And now this is again an amazing question. It has a lot of connection to the, Guwahati, Assam. Anyways, option A is an administrative functionary, a religious sect, cultural minister in Jahangir court, and details a style of temple construction. So now the question is all about the cultural history of India. So now when it is about the culture, when the keyword is all about the cultural history, the term Nilachal refers to what? Don't you think so? It could either be option B or D. Anyway, option B, C talks about the cultural minister. Definitely it cannot be the case because we're talking about the cultural history. So it could be a religious sect or a style of temple construction. A style of temple construction, give you an idea regarding the cultural impact or history of our country, right? So more or less in that case, I can tell you that option D could be the right answer. And yes, guys, the answer is option D, which means that it's a style of temple construction. And if you see the Ambubachi Mela, which is celebrated in the capital city of Guwahati in Assam, that's one of the most important festival of the Kamakhya temple of Guwahati, guys. Again, just like how I told you about the Pakshikashi, in Karnataka, the bird sanctuary. Again, Kamakhya temple in Guwahati in Assam is a wonderful place to visit, guys. It's in the Hindu tradition of mythology, I can tell you that. It's a place where a lot of religious people do visit every time. Anyway, I myself have been to this particular place. It's really amazing. And if you get a chance to visit the Kamakhya temple, do go and visit, guys. It's a wonderful place to go and see. And now there's a lot of historical, background also for this particular temple because it's a Hindu temple dedicated to Mother Goddess Kamakhya. She is the form of Kali, Ma Kali, the goddess Kali. And it is one of the oldest of the 51 Shakti Pithas. So now, out of the 51 Shakti Pithas, it's a little, Hindu thing. It's the oldest of that. That's the importance of this Kamakhya temple. And also another important importance of this Kamakhya temple is that the girl children, they have been given a lot of respect and they have been worshipped there actually. So that is again another added advantage of this Kamakhya temple where the females are given recognition, guys. That also adds to the importance of this particular temple called as Kamakhya temple. Okay. And it's a beautiful place, guys, really. And as if you go seriously, make a point, literally, you do not miss out visiting this famous historical site or this religious temple there. And now, this current structural temple, guys, that was built and renovated many a times way back in the period 8th to 17th century. And now, because of that, it gave rise to a lot of hybrid indigenous style of architecture, and that is sometimes called as a Nilachal type. And that is because of the continuous renovation done to this particular temple, from your 8th to 17th century only, it is called as Nilachal type, okay? And now, this Nilachal type, what is that? It's nothing but a type of Hindu temple architecture in Assam. And a country, India, that is characterized by a builder's polygonal dome over a curiously formed ratha type bada and all, okay. And now this kind of hybrid style, I can tell you, it was developed very first in the temple, that's Kamakhya temple on the Nilachal hills under the kingdom called the Scotch kingdom, guys. And that is how it became very, very popular as a style later under the Ahom kingdom. And if you see that temple, it is like a, tomb. It's very amazing to see that temple also, guys. Anyways, when you do get a chance, visit it. And not only this place, there are a lot of religious places, where you can visit. When you visit places, it is good if you, have a look at all this. Anyways, this particular question has been taken from Times of India, and also the link is given here, guys. So if you want to have more information regarding this particular Kamakhya temple of Guwahati and Gandhi devotees, you can just log on to this site, or you can copy paste this and read it, okay? It is from the Times of India, this information has been taken. The next one, the last one for today's session, and the last question. Consider the following statements with respect to man-portable anti-tank guided missile. Option 1 is, it is a third generation anti-tank guided missile. 2, it is developed by DRDO. 3, it has strike range of 2.5 km. Quickly give me the right answers, guys. Option 1 is 1 and 3, B2, C1 and 2, and it is all the above. A very, very simple question, and all of us know the answer is option number D, which means that all the above statements are right. So the keyword is man-portable anti-tank guided missile. So obviously, when it is a man-portable one, it will be a third generation one. And also, it will be by your Defense Research Development Organization. And thus, if you see, your MPATGM, that is nothing but a third generation anti-guided missile. It is developed by your DRDO. And yes, it has a strike range of 2.5 km. And what about the weight, guys? It is weighing around 14.5 kg. Why? Only then they'll be able to maintain the man portability, because it has to be portable also, right? And thus, it is capable of being fired from shoulder. And that at the same time, it can also be during used during your day and night. It's not only for night or day. Both the times you can use it, okay? That's an advantage of your ATGM. And also, it has minimum lateral send and gravity offset. So these are the advantages which, leads to the, more and more usage of your man-portable anti-tank guided missile. So I hope these set of 10 questions what we discussed today has enabled you to have a thorough understanding regarding the June 25th, 2019 current affairs. And also, guys, if you do have any doubt, please feel free to put all your doubts and queries or your comments or feedbacks via the YouTube comment box. So yes, thank you so much, my dear students. So please do rate, review, recommend, and follow me for more such courses in various platforms, be it both offline as well as online. And also, you can follow me via my Telegram channel, and the name of my Telegram channel is Learn Economics with Nisha for UPSC. And also have a YouTube channel called as Nisha Nujumuddin for UPSC. You can even follow me there also for more updates and live sessions. And again, at Kingmakers platform, online platform as well as offline platform, you can follow me there because my faculty here. And any doubts you have, please put it in the comment box. I will revert back to you as and when I see it. And also, whatever feedbacks you want to put forward, also you're free to do it. So once again, thank you so much, guys, and stay tuned for more upcoming live sessions on a daily basis. Bye bye.